afternoon. Good evening. It is February 1st, Monday, February 1st, 2016. My name is Shalfus, and this is the Daily Rocket. So today, on the Daily Rocket, we are covering this past week in esports, and I realize now that I forgot to make one graphic. Out of all the events that happened this weekend, there was one that I forgot to make for, because I usually don't talk about it on Mondays. And that's a failure on my part, but it's okay, we'll still talk about it. In fact, we'll go ahead and make sure we talk about that one first. So, this past weekend we saw a lot of esports action, a lot of competition going on, including this past Saturday, which saw the Gfinity Invitational. Now this was a special one-time Gfinity event, well, presumably one time, but a special Gfinity event which took the top 8 teams in Europe, the best 8 teams in Europe, and pit them against one another in a 450-pound prize pool event. And basically, it was an 8-team double elimination bracket. Myself, Freezing Wolves, Shogun, and The Pash all across two streams covered every single game of this tournament. It was very interesting. And I just saw that donation message. That's crazy. Anyway, it was really a big deal there. It was a lot of fun, had some incredible results. Ultimately, the event was taken by Flipside Tactics, which a lot of people probably wouldn't be surprised to hear that results, but what you would be surprised to hear would be how we got to Flipside winning that event. In the first round, Flipside took on Noble Esports and was 4-0'd by Noble and sent to the loser's bracket. So Flipside had to start in the lower bracket and fight their way into the grand finals. But to give you a picture of how this went for Flipside. So they lost 4-0 in the first round. They proceeded to 4-0 SK Gaming in the lower bracket and eliminate them. 4-1 Crown and Jewels and eliminate them. Then they had this series against Spectral. Now this was the kind of series that you would dream of having in a grand final. Unfortunately, it was in the lower bracket semi-final, so to say. You know, you can't really use those terms with a loser's bracket, but the point being is that it was the last match before the final that would... before the final that would allow them to qualify for the finals. So, anyway. But this series against Spectral was incredible. It ultimately ended in 7 games in an overtime in Game 7 that just slightly tilted in the favor of Flipside Tactics, but Spectral had Flipside on the verge of elimination in that series, but they just weren't able to seal the deal in overtime. But once Flipside made it past Spectral, they would not lose a single game. They would 4-0 MyXMG, who lost the winner's bracket final, then they would make it to the grand final against Supersonic Avengers and win that series 5-0. So Flipside Tactics would take that tournament, only losing 4 games in total, sorry, 8 games in total. They would lose 4 games in total after that Noble defeat. So a very impressive tournament. It was a lot of fun. It was a long day. I was shoutcasting for a little over 8 hours that day, presenting that event. But it was well worth it. It was a lot of fun. And I'm hoping we get to see a little bit more out of Gfinity in the coming weeks. Obviously, their regular tournament will resume. We'll see where it winds up and what other stuff is in store. But you can also sign up for Gfinity tournaments just by going to gfinity.net, click on the Rocket League button, on play, and sign up for those events for free. Now, this is a European tournament, so I believe you can play if you are in NA. Just remember that you will be playing on European servers. So if you can do that, you're more than welcome to it. But in any event, a good start to things for the week. So with that, let's talk about some of the other events. To answer that question very quickly, Flipside lost to Noble in the first match of the day in the winner's bracket. They lost to Noble 4-0. It was a very surprising result from a Noble team that was really just came out swinging. So, but let's get started talking about some of the other events from this past week, because I think that's important. And we'll start with ESL Europe. So the first tournament on Sunday was the European ESL Gofore Rocket League event, cup number 27. Our final eight teams in this event were Team Rocket, RG Esports, Stoic, ECN Surf, Galactic Lions, Comrade Gaming, and the Three Musketeers. Team Rocket would make it past but they would be held up against Stoic. At that point, ECN Surf would also get past Galactic Lions, though they get shut out by the eventual winners, who would be the Three Musketeers, who would take out Stoic in the finals. So that should be 4-2 in the finals there. my apologies for the error in the graphic, but point being, Three Musketeers would walk away victorious this week, so maybe a little bit of a resurgence on their part. They've gone a little quiet recently, and by winning ESL, that could be a big change of pace for them, just to get back into the swing of things and hopefully be a major contender back in the European Rocket League scene again. But we'll have to see how that goes. It's always just strange stuff. You never really know what's going to happen in Europe. It's such a competitive division of Rocket League. But in any event, congratulations out to the Three Musketeers. That takes us to ESL NA. And that would see the final eight teams being Turbulence, Ascension, IBP Cosmic, Foremost, Double Tap, 2ARC, ECN Royalty, and Weebs on Wheels. So a couple quick notes about this before we go further. To start, the result of Cosmic and the fact that Cosmic is in this tournament, it was not the usual Cosmic team. In fact, this was Gibbs, Doomsie, and A-Money. So there was no Kernovi, there was no Sad Junior. Kernovi obviously back down in PAC South winning tournaments and earning himself little trinkets. And Sad Junior, God only knows. But in any event, this was not the usual IBP Cosmic. And they would go up against a very formidable Turbulence team in the second to last round of the semifinals and just barely get eliminated by Turbulence, who would move on to the grand final against Double Tap. And it would be there that Turbulence would take the win 4-0. So a shutout grand finals win in ESL NA27. A very nice performance there. Another thing of note out of this NA tournament, if you look back to the EU results, both of ECN's teams would actually would make it into the final four. In fact, it was ECN Surf that would actually make it into the semifinals on the EU side. So really good performance out of both ECN teams this week to get them into that top eight. So now that we've talked ESL, we have talked Gfinity, there's only one thing left to do, and that is RLC Pro League. Week four was this past Sunday, and these are your results from said event. That is not the right graphic. My God, I added the wrong thing. Let's see if this works. It did not. Of course it didn't work. I'll tell you what we'll do. Give me just a second. I can get this taken care of super fast. Relatively fast. Moderately fast. Gotta go fast. Alright. There are your week four results. Much better, right? So for this week, it was the first week in RLC without a 5-0 loss in any of the matches. Now Cosmic, as well as Supersonic Avengers, were on the bye this week. But if we take a look at the results on the EU division, Spectral would continue their winning ways, going 4-1 against SK Gaming, having a very outstanding showing against that team. Flipside Tactics would manage to edge out MyXMG, who was coming through pretty eagerly, hoping to dethrone the champions. And because of that result, and the following result, which saw Crown and Jewels take out Noble 2-3, that would mean that Crown and Jewels would retain their number one spot in the European division for at least another week. So despite Flipside being hot on their heels, and despite the fact that Flipside defeated them head-to-head just a week ago, it still meant that they will retain that number one position. We'll look at the standings and stats in just a few. On the NA side, a huge result. Failure to launch would defeat Orange Creamsicle, who would be without their star player Gambit, and would lose 4-1 in that series. Another shocking result, Apollo 11, 4-1 against Never on Target. This was particularly surprising, but it further goes to show the downturn of Team Knot as of late. So, really shocking result there to see that Knot would drop to Apollo 11, and that's certainly not a dig against Apollo, but they are a very effective team. However, I don't think a lot of people expected them to dominate that series quite as much as they did, and a lot of that credit, I think, has to go to Prime Thunder, who returned to the team this past week and just looked outstanding. Now, normally it would be Flo who would be in that third spot with Husky and Ozzy, but it was Prime Thunder who came back and was just a big MVP for his team, setting up shots, getting huge goals, being extremely effective. So, overall, Apollo 11, a very formidable squad, really establishing their dominance and putting Knot in a bad, bad place with only 3 weeks of the season to go. Finally, hands down the best series of the day, it would see Kings of Urban go up against Untethered. Now, this series was, for lack of a better term, ridiculous. And the scoreline of the series being 4-1 in favor of Kings of Urban is in no way indicative of just how competitive that series was. Practically every game was decided by a single goal. Many went into overtime. Untethered put up the kind of fight that really was impressive. So, I mean, Untethered came out swinging and, in my opinion, deserved more wins than they wound up getting. But the thing is that this series was a big indication of why so many people argue that Kings of Urban should be the number one team in North America. Because when their backs are to the wall, when the pressure's on, they deliver. They are a solid clutch team. And in fact, we talked about this during the broadcast, they have a record of 13-0 when they score first in the RPL. So every time they put in that first goal, they become a dominant team. And in fact, it should be said that most teams will win the game if they score first, based off of the entire Pro League results. But the fact is, it was just too much for Untethered to handle, but by no means, despite the fact that it was a 4-1 score, by no means was Untethered outclassed or outplayed. They just gave the slightest edge to a team that is hands down one of the best in the world. And Kings of Urban certainly deserved that series, but I think Untethered fought like a team that could have gone 3-2 or maybe even 2-3. You know, in the other direction, I should say. So, but it was a great series. I had a blast casting it with James Bott. But this was really a very interesting week for the Pro League. I mean, it turned a lot of things on their head. And with that in mind, let's take a look at the current standings. Sorry. At the current standings for both Europe and North America. We'll start with the European region. So here's where we sit right now in the EU region. As I mentioned before, Crown and Jewels still just barely holding on to that number one spot because they have one more win than Flipside. So they could retain that number one seed depending on how the rest of their season goes. Flipside Tactics again coming in second place. Not a lot of movement here this week on the EU side. Supersonic Avengers coming in third. MyXMG holding up that fourth spot, and that rounds up your current playoff qualifiers. But Spectral would bump up ahead here, finally taking that fifth spot, and they're not that far outside of getting into that top 10, or that top 4, because of, right now, their goal differential being the big deciding factor here. So, really a huge thing to decide there. Noble Esports coming in at 6, and SK Gaming still struggling, having a big opportunity on their plates, coming in last place this week. Now, as far as the performance goes, we could take a look at everything. Crown and Jewels still leading the pack, at least on the EU side, in terms of shot percentage, but their dominating performance has been overshadowed a bit by the fact that on the NA side, another team has the best shot percentage in the league, and we'll talk about them when we get over to the NA side, because it's kind of a surprising name, in my opinion. But other than that, every team here, except for MyXMG, breaking 0.3 in shot percentage. We can take a look at overall shots, and the thing that really stands out to me the most is Crown and Jewels have played played a full 20 games so far. They have 145 total shots across those games. Supersonic Avengers has only played 15 games, and they have 5 more shots. I mean, they are a relentless team, almost breaking 10 shots per game average, just to show that this is a squad that has a very relentless style, very similar to Flipside Tactics in how they approach their attack. So, but the one stat that I think really, really stands out here too is the assists number. And if we take a look at assists, Flipside Tactics, 51 of their 66 goals came from an assist. I mean, if you can look at every other team on here, and nobody's even breaking 40. But Flipside Tactics has already cleared 50. And they are well ahead of the pack here, so pretty solid stuff on the part of Flipside Tactics. But again, they are just outside of that number one spot because of one loss. So it's going to be up to Flipside to try and cover that one loss gap. They couldn't do it against MyXMG. We'll see if they can pull it off next week. But that is what your EU side looks like right now. On the NA side, here are your NA standings. Now, technically, because of their win total, Kings of Urban moves up into first place. Cosmic getting shifted down to second. Failure to Launch. Yeah, that's right. Failure to Launch is in third place right now. Untethered coming in fourth. Apollo 11 just barely outside of the top four because of that goal differential right now. Not currently Mocket Esports. They are coming in sixth, and Orange Creamsicle in at seventh. So a very big shift to the top seven here in the Pro League. But Failure to Launch, a huge commendation goes their way to making it into that top three. And this is the biggest thing right now is in the EU, in the NA region, the 1 and 2 are clearly a big fight between Cosmic and Kings of Urban. And that all really comes down to next week's matchup. We're going to talk about next week's matchup in just a second, but I mean, looking at what we've got here, Kings of Urban has been a very dominant team as of late. Cosmic had the week off, so they're going to be coming back next week, of course. And we know what their big game is next week. And that'll help determine a lot. But Failure to Launch has really looked impressive with their big win over Never on Target, now Mocket Esports, as well as their huge win this past week. They're in a very good place in these Pro League standings. Now, the rest of the season that goes on, they're going to have more tests that will allow them to probably own that position a little bit better. But the big surprise here, in my opinion, comes down to the very bottom of the charts. Mocket Esports, it's 6-14. With a negative 22 goal differential. I mean, this is a team that had been considered for a very long time to be one of the top teams in North America. They were number one, tied for number one for a week. They were in the top three week over week. But since then, their performance has just fallen off. And it's really surprising, in my opinion, because if you look at this team on paper, they have three amazingly talented players in Low 5, Classics, and Kyle Mass. These are three players who are extremely effective, very talented, but they might be falling into that trap of not quite gelling as a team. And this is something that I find interesting, because a lot of people ask me about all-star teams, and it's something that we've also talked about because a lot of people talk about the idea of like a World Cup for Rocket League. And one of the factors that always gets kicked around is how do you decide who those players are going to be? Like, who makes that decision? Is it just the three best? Is it, you know, standings in the in-game ranked thing? Or what is it? And one of that decisions is if even if you pick the top three players in your country or the top three players in your region, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have the best team. You know, you take a look at Kings of Urban, and while you might think that many of those players are really stellar individually, when you crank off a list of the top five, you might not have all of those people on your list. But as a team, they gel so well, they work together so well, that that's a big factor. So Kings of Urban is a good example of a team of three great players who also just become a great team. Whereas Mocket Esports might be the contrary. Three great players who might not make a great team. We'll have to see how they recover. There are still 3 weeks of the regular season to go. They only have 10 more games left to try and get themselves out of this hole. So number one is impossible for Mocket right now. But they can still very much qualify for the playoffs. We'll probably have a better picture of what the playoff situation looks like after next week or after week six. But regardless of that, some very interesting standings on the NA side. So let's take a peek at next week's schedule, week five, for the RLC Pro League. On the EU side, Flipside Tactics goes up against the number three Supersonic Avengers in what I expect to be a very heavy offensive showdown. It might not result in a lot of goals, but you're probably going to see both sides pepper the net quite a bit with shots. That's what they're known for. So we might see a lot of that on this side. And of course, I think Avengers are hoping to get a little bit of a revenge after this past Saturday's Gfinity. Further down, we have Spectral going up against MyXMG. Now, Spectral riding a big wave of momentum going up against MyXMG, who also pulled a couple of games off of Flipside. So both of these teams have managed to claim a few games off of Flipside, and they're looking for their chance to secure a spot in the finals. And MyXMG holds on to a precarious number 4 right now, so it could be a good chance for Spectral to move in. On the last game on the EU side, SK Gaming goes up against Noble Esports. So this would be another showdown, a big chance for Noble to help move up the rankings here, and a really good chance for them to establish their place going forward with only a few weeks left. On the NA side, of course, the highlight match, the showcase match, the match we all want to see, Kings of Urban versus IBP Cosmic. So this matchup will not only assuredly decide the number one team in the RPL, but it's also probably going to decide unequivocally the number one power rank team. So you're looking at two teams that have been dominating the NA side and will assuredly put on a great show. Further down, Mocket Esports is going to be going up against Untethered. Now, this is another big test for Mocket right now, but quite frankly, with the way they've been performing and the way Untethered has looked, especially in that last series against Kings of Urban, they're going to have a really difficult time. Untethered is looking to be a dominant and on fire NA team right now, and they are really going to challenge Mocket. And I'd be, unless their game has turned completely around, I'd be surprised if they got out of that series with a winning record. Finally, Apollo 11 going up against Orange Creamsicle. So I think OC's performance is going to depend a lot on whether or not Gambit is present. Not having Gambit on that team clearly ruffles things up a little bit on their end, and Apollo 11 had a tremendous week on Sunday, looking like a surefire dominant team. So that is going to be a very interesting matchup to see, depending on how both these teams go, and especially considering if Apollo 11 decides to use Prime Thunder again, or if Flo returns to the lineup. So I think that could also play a considerable factor, considering his playmaking ability. That's been the big deciding factor, I think, just setting things up for his teammates. But in any event, obviously the biggest match we're looking forward to is Cosmic versus Kings of Urban. And in that series, it's going to be a very interesting thing to decide, because as it stands right now, we haven't seen this matchup in a while. We know how good Kings are, and we know how good Cosmic is. But with the way Kings have been playing, they might have the edge here. We will find out on Sunday when this Pro League event occurs. Six games coming up on Sunday. It should be very exciting to see. So, in any event, there is your RPL recap for this week. So there we go. Well, now is the time where we do our usual thing, and I turn to you, the chat, to tell me or ask me any questions you may have about the competitive scene, about the game, the power rankings, whatever you want to ask about, the floor is open. It is Q&A time, now that we have recapped this past week, so let's get to it. Any questions you may have, fire away, drop them in the chat, let's get down to business. Alright, am I going to stream a match? Not today. I have nothing to stream competitively. This is just a talk show. Yeezy has been very effective, absolutely. How are my sound bites going? They're not. I haven't been asked to do any. Who do I think will win? Kings of Urban or Cosmic, and what will be the score? With the fact that Gibbs will not be present during that series, could be a deciding factor a little bit, but I will say the fact that Kronovi and Sad Jr. will be there probably covers most of the situation, and it'll be interesting. You know, I'm not sure how effective A-Money is on that defensive position, or if they're going to have to change up their approach, which could be a big deciding factor. So because of that, I'd have to give the nod to Kings of Urban. Probably give them at least a 3-2 nod here. But it's hard to say. You know, it's definitely a little hard to say for sure. That's going to be a really interesting matchup, undoubtedly. There are 3 more weeks left of the regular season before playoffs. So week 7 will be the last week. Then there will be the All-Star game. And that will help determine home field advantage for the playoffs, and then ultimately we will have the playoffs themselves. I don't know for sure if any actions or so are going to be decided for that sort of stuff. The problem is that we're in a situation where we only have a certain amount of teams, and we don't. Our job is to put on a show, and if they're late, you know, there's not too much we can do, really. It's something to consider if we do a season 2 of the Pro League, but for right now, we just have to kind of do what we can, and try to protect everything. Is team not out of the playoffs? No, no team right now is mathematically eliminated from the playoffs. There are still too many games left to take a team out. Because if we go back and just look at the standings really quick, let me flick to, alright, so if we take a look at NA, this is what our NA our setup looks like right now, and there are teams that are mathematically eliminated from getting first place, that is for sure, but the top 4 teams are going to qualify for the playoffs, and right now Failure to Launch has 7 wins, and any of those teams below them are just within a few games. And there are still 3 weeks to go, which means most of these teams have 10 to 15 games left to play. They'll have 30 in total by the time the season's done, so we'll have a better picture probably in a few weeks on that. And it's the same kind of situation on EU. We can see, you know, Supersonic and MyXMG have 8 and 7 wins respectively. Very easy for all 3 of the remaining teams to cover that gap. So, there is no way that any of these teams are mathematically eliminated, but there are, just based off of trends, certain expectations you can probably make, certain guesses you can probably make for how this stuff's going to play out. But as it stands right now, no, everything's fine. And any team can qualify. You have 1 or 2 good weeks and you might be able to edge out and up somebody right above you and claim like that last spot. So that's the important detail there, but no team is out of the playoffs yet. Yeah, SA and F3 are very offensively minded, and they will, like I said, they kind of pepper the net with shots, and that's why that matchup is going to be so interesting on Sunday, as to just how competitive or how much offense we're going to see out of it. I mean, I could see where you're coming from, Ember. You know, to penalize a team, and that's something we'd have to consider for season two. Here's the problem that we're in right now, as well. We, as a competitive scene, as competitive event organizers, are kind of at the mercy of the teams that want to play in it right now because everything is so small. We're not in a position where we can really demand a lot or penalize a lot because of just the size of everything. And we hold the cards of having this big competitive tournament with a massive prize pool that, you know, we're giving so much publicity to, and we get so much viewership, and it's a really fantastic event. But we're such a small event that, you know, we are not in a good position of power right now. But in the weeks to come, and as time changes, I'm sure that that dynamic will shift dramatically, and you know, we'll start holding all the cards a little bit better. But as for now, it's something definitely we need to consider for season two, that if a team qualifies for an event, they got to be there on time. And if they're not, you know, we got to do something about it. Did ESPN retweet your montage about getting RL into ESPN? They did not. I got many other retweets, though, supporting that. So I don't think we've made it quite yet. So the campaign continues. Hashtag RL on ESPN. Yeah, there's a chance that Knott won't make it. Or Mockett won't make it now. I don't know if they're in the top five. I have to take a really hard look at the power rankings this week when I'm doing them to figure that out. You know, I mean, I can see the complaint about the latency issues in game, and it's something we would like to do, but the situation right now is that we don't have a central broadcast location where we can switch the entire casting team. And right now, the only people who are capable of hosting the RLC broadcast are myself, James Bot, and the Pash. So, two NA and one EU. We can get Pash to do EU, but then he's gonna have the same problem when he hosts NA. So, we can't switch who hosts it without killing the stream. When that time comes, if we can have a central camera person, so to say, when they add more spectator spots, then, you know, maybe we can do something about it. But either way, it's still going to be a problem because we don't have a central location where all these games come from. So one of the two games is going to be a problem. Or one of the two sets of games, I should say. Yeah, there were some amazing goals in that Kings of Urban series. That whole series was ridiculously exciting. So I think it was fantastic. The prize pool right now, I believe, is last I heard, it was at around 2,000. I don't know if it's gone up at all yet, but you know, we've been doing donations are great. The more donations and subs that they get on that channel, all go towards the possibly increased prize pool. Yeah, I don't know for sure. No disrespect or anything like that. I mean, I know that there's some changes that need to be made, and that's what this first season's been about, is giving us the opportunity to see how this all goes, organize the event, and then come back next season, assuming we do a second season, to iron everything out and have a you know, cover all these little issues. But I'm hoping we can do a second season. There's been a lot of excitement around the Pro League. I'm a big fan of the stats and stuff, and we've got a couple of stats guys who are just amazing with the stuff they pull together and give us to talk about in game. It's really, like, hands down, RPL or just RLC events entirely are the best stuff in Rocket League right now. Like, not only are you getting the best teams in the world, but it's also just the most well-organized, well-produced thing on the market. If you guys even knew the half of what goes on behind the scenes, you'd be really impressed by what this team of volunteers basically does and what we've done consistently. And it's so awesome because we work really hard to put on a great show, and there's so many people between rocket-league.com, the guys who maintain the website and build everything and customize all of our overlays and graphics and things like that, the work that they do, the work that is done by the stats guys, D-Pants and CJ, who constantly are poring over stats, creating replays, giving us things that we can go over during the game. I mean, that kind of stuff you don't see in another tournament because you don't have that kind of staffing. It's usually just two casters and an admin trying to put together something. And then you've got us as casters who are trying to do our due diligence and research and keep on top of teams and have talking points and things like that. So we have some of the best casters in the world, the best stats guys in the world, the best producers. Our admins are on point. They get things done. And it is so much fun, and I'm so proud to be a part of Rocket League Central, being able to host these events, so it is really fun. What do you find to be the hardest when organizing the Pro League? Initially, the scheduling. The scheduling was the hardest. Now, it actually relatively runs smoothly. You know, now that we've got everything relatively figured out as far as how it's going to go, it's pretty smooth, but the scheduling has to be the hardest part, and Cloud Fuel bears the brunt of that. He's, you know, of course, the owner slash president, kind of Rocket League Central, and the guy who runs the thing, basically, from top to bottom. And he was responsible for organizing this past week's schedule, reorganizing the schedule, to make sure that certain teams' availability could be accommodated during that set. So that worked out pretty well, and we had... It didn't follow the EU-EU-EU-NA-NA-NA format that we've done in the past few weeks, but it was still a great schedule. We got all six games done. There were a few delays, of course, just due to team issues, but we still got it done. We had a great broadcast. We've got so many people working on the video editing. I mean, between the amazing edited opening that the tournament now has, and the top five plays every week, and just all the effort that goes into this tournament is so impressive, and I am just a tiny sliver of what so many other people do for Rocket League Central and the RLC Pro League. Like, I would dare say, and I would challenge anybody to fight me on this, we are the best Rocket League content on the internet right now. So, that is how I feel. It is my opinion, of course, but I stand by that 100%. We are the best tournament, the best broadcast, the most well-polished stuff, with the best casters, period. What rank will I put not this week? I don't know. I have no idea. I have to pore over some information before I can decide where not goes. Yeah, I mean, here's the situation about substitutes, because this is important. We tried to have a more formatted, a more predictable substitution situation with how we did rosters for the RPL. The problem was, and this still applies, we're such a small scene that players aren't being paid to play like they are in other esports. You know, if you look at other esports, bigger esports, you have teams that get signed and paid, and they can also sign substitutes who are still part of the team, and they get paid. You know, they just get paid more, or get more of the cut of the share, cut of everything when they play. So there's a perk to playing, but there's also a perk to being on the team as a sub. We don't have that in Rocket League. People aren't being paid to be subs, so substitutes have to be able to come in and cover things. And plus, it's all online as well, so if you're running late in traffic, if your internet goes out, if your power goes out, you're kind of stuck. And you're leaving your team kind of high and dry, and they have to start clamoring around to find somebody, anybody, to fill in. And that's just the nature of this beast right now, and that's a little hard to deal with, so we try to accommodate it as best we can, because our goal on our end is to give you guys six amazing games every week. And when we get to the playoffs, a tournament full of amazing games that aren't decided because of back-end stuff. You know, we don't want a tournament to be decided because of a penalized loss or a forfeit or something like that. We want all these teams to play as best they can and give you competitive Rocket League. And sometimes that means it takes time, you know, but that's our goal. Well, thank you very much, Embers. I mean, I know that we try really hard to do that. Where can you get this shirt? Just go to RocketLeagueStore.com. It's the official Rocket League store. I think they have it on there. I got sent this one from Psionic, so. Who do you say has the best offense in NA? Kings of Urban. Definitely. Definitely Kings. Yeah, I have no problem with pointing out issues. You know, I know for a fact we're not doing this Pro League perfectly. I don't think we'll ever be able to do it perfectly. But it's good to know things that people think we can improve on or change or adjust. And it's something we always will take into consideration when we do it again. You know, it's a little late to do any big changes now, especially for Season 1. But there's certainly stuff to consider if we do Season 2. You know it did. I got mine, Shogun. Came in a little ass box. Well, I think Prime Thunder was part of their official roster. Because Apollo had always consisted of Husky, Ozzy, Flo, Prime Thunder, and I can't remember his name. I feel terrible. They had a five-man setup, I'm pretty sure, that made up their team, and I just can't remember the fifth name off the top of my head. But the point being is that I'm pretty sure this was their full roster signed up before RPL began. So there's no surprise that or problem with them using Prime Thunder. It's not like he's a super sub. You know, he's been a part of Apollo's roster since the start. No, I don't think it's Maestro. There was somebody else. I would have to check. They have a normal fifth person as part of that lineup, and I think he was part of SNK Apollo too. Oh, there isn't a blue one? Oh, I am special. So, I can't help you. Apparently this is a special person shirt. I don't know. I literally had no idea. They just sent me this. My thought about Maestro. I got confused. My thoughts about Maestro. Maestro is a great player. I think he is fantastic. He's been a great addition to Supersonic Avengers. They are a very formidable squad with him on board. And Avengers is a lot of fun to watch, too. That is for sure. Is there going to be a Season 2? I don't know. I hope so. I'd like to see a Season 2. I love the Pro League. I love the fact that we can do this every week and it's so hype and people get so excited about it. There's a lot of things that have to be considered when we talk about a Season 2. So for right now, I have no idea. So let's just enjoy Season 1 while we can. But it really is good stuff. Do you think SNK had a justified reason to drop sponsorship for Apollo? It was actually the other way around. Apollo decided to part ways with SNK. That whole situation, I don't really know the ins and outs of it. I know what both parties are saying. It was settled before I even joined SNK. So I knew going into it that SNK was leaving Apollo. Or that Apollo was leaving SNK. I knew that was going to happen before I even joined. And I still joined with the intent of trying to find a new team to bring on board. And I'm still doing that. I'm still working on that. So. Let's see. Oh, there is a blue one. Okay, so I'm not so special. Whatever. Okay, Mr. Paul. I like focusing on the play-by-play, and that's what I did. If you look back and you watch Gfinity, that's kind of what I did during that. But I do like to talk about moments a little bit and provide, you know, a little bit of flavor to what's happening in the game and talk about why things are going on. So I've always fallen into that being capable of both sort of role. Especially when I started out, because I started doing this back at the very beginning, and there weren't a lot of casters back then for Rocket League. I think the only two when I started were myself and Freezing Wolves. And we were basically the only two around. So I just kind of fell into doing both because I solo casted a lot of stuff. And yeah, that's why I try to be versatile, because when I'm casting with JamesBot, I know I can go into color. But when I'm casting with Shogun, I have to do play-by-play because he is far beyond the best color guy in Rocket League, in my opinion. I think he is outstanding at providing color commentary. And I hope he's still here to hear this, because there is no denying that I love working with Shogun. I really do. I think he has one of the best personalities in the game. He is one of my personal favorite shoutcasters because of what he brings to everything he does. So I am really glad that, you know, he's doing this. Team Rocket didn't qualify for the RPL. That's their only problem. We had to go through... a lot of people might just be discovering the RLC Pro League. So to give you a bit of an idea of how this worked out at the very beginning, last year we started with an open qualifier. Basically, we allowed any team to sign up and participate in this open bracket. And the result was that it was both EU and NA. There were two separate tournaments. And it was playing for 8 spots in the qualifier. So any team could sign up and they could play for one of these 8 spots. And if they made it into one of those 8 spots, the next week was the qualifier. And that was 16 teams, 8 teams that had been pre-selected based off of their performance as of recent, and then 8 teams that qualified from the open bracket. Those 16 teams played a double elimination bracket that then resulted in the final 5 teams that would move into the Pro League. And that's where we got our full season right now. And the only team that made it out of the open bracket all the way to the Pro League was Failure to Launch. And they are looking outstanding right now. So they're currently placed third. We'll see how the rest of the season goes, but they certainly looked amazing. Based off the fact that I haven't heard anything from Shogun, I think he may not have heard that, so maybe I'll be able to get rid of this. But yeah, I really enjoy working with Shogun. I would work with him all the time if I was able to. He is an amazing shoutcaster and just a lot of fun. But yeah, it's all about who I cast with as to what role I fill. That's why you'll see when I'm casting with the Pash in particular, the Pash, he knows he's a play-by-play guy. He knows that, and that's what he's best at. That's what he feels he's most comfortable in. So I fall into that color commentary role. But, you know, with guys like Shogun or Freezing Wolves, they can support themselves in color, so I'll go into play-by-play. JamesBot, I feel, could do either. Because he's a former player, or I guess a current player, depending on how you want to look at it, because he's a player, he has a lot of insight that's very valuable to the color side. So I think we could cast either way. There is strategy involved. I mean, there's a strategy that is part of that style. But many teams, like, you have to adjust your normal style in order to be successful against certain opponents. You know? And this was something I pointed out in particular, for an example, with Crown and Jewels. If you look at their first 2 weeks in the Pro League, where they 5-0'd their opponents, they went up against opponents who gave them time and space. When they are given time and space, they will orchestrate things like they are conducting a symphony. They will set up shots. They had huge assist numbers. They had great shot percentage, the best in the league, over 0.5%. Or over 50%, I should say. So they were just, you know, dominating there. But once Flipside got them and started to pressure them and cut out that space, didn't give them that time, that's when they started to have to adapt. They tried adapting a bit during Gfinity and falling a little more into that very aggressive three forward style of rotational play, but it's something that they weren't really usually doing, so it was a little trickier. So that's what a team has to do. A team just has to pressure them out and adjust their style, and that's what, you know, some teams just have to do, is change up how they play to accommodate for what their opponents are doing, or what's working and not working. So there is strategy involved, but yeah, it starts with their basic style. How do they usually play? Then how do they accommodate for their opponents if they have to? Alright, where am I at now? Predictions on Cosmic versus Kings. Same as before, I think Kings will probably take the series, and it will still be a lot of fun to watch. The fact that Gibbs won't be there is going to be a big factor, though. But I don't know if it'll be a major, major factor. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. Yeah, I don't know if it's going to go into overtime every game, but it will definitely be extremely competitive, I think. At least it certainly feels like it will be. Who's better, Gibbs or Mike? Mike. Definitely Mike. I mean, that's no disrespect to Gibbs, but Mike Rules is probably one of the best players in the world. A lot of people will argue it's either he or Marky, who are the top two in the world. Or, they're considered the top two. Oh. Hi, Uro.
Defcon 5.5 was here. Hi, just wanted to let you know that EU greater than US, like your casting. Shogun is best streamer EU, you are best US. Shout out to Cool Cole Babyface Ginger.
Alright, well, thank you for that. Thank you very much. Much, much appreciated for the donation. Alright, let me keep going on here. I mean, I was using Flipside as an example, but Flipside is kind of beyond being used as an example in a lot of cases. They are a very special case scenario in a lot of the stuff they do. Yeah, I don't think Flipside lost to Noble on purpose. I just don't know. I mean, yeah, sometimes they just pop in and be like, okay, let's start playing. And then they go up against a team that's really well warmed up and they get a little, you know, thrown off their game. But then they came back and just, they only lost four games after that series in Gfinity. So, you know, they know what they're doing. See, here, when I talk about strategy, another thing to keep in mind is I might not be talking about, like, I'll talk about a strategy, but that doesn't mean that I'm saying that these teams, you know, practiced a certain way in advance. But it does mean that they're playing a certain strategy that maybe they just decided to do on the fly, maybe they just do it naturally, whatever it might be. That's when we're talking about strategy, that's kind of the idea behind it. Yeah, Flipside is, they're a weird animal, man. They are hard to figure out. Gibbs is on IVP Cosmic. A-Money is a sub, yes. A-Money is substituting for Gibbs next week in the RLC Pro League. And yeah, he's just a substitute. What is the best up-and-coming team? What do you define up-and-coming as? I mean, I think that's an important question. Gibbs does play. He just played in ESL yesterday. He, Doomsy, and A-Money just played in ESL. He just is going to be off this weekend, next weekend. Anyway, yeah, I need to know what you mean by up-and-coming. Oh, not in the Pro League? Oh, there's... There are a lot of good teams not in the Pro League. Man. Well, on the European side, it's kind of clustered and confusing. there's a lot of teams that seem to edge into that number 8 spot, so to say. On the NA side, it's a little clearer. I would say Turbulence is a big squad there. Probably one of the more formidable non-pro league teams. Definitely a team to keep an eye on. But Stoic is good too. I mean, they got a big showing in the ESL this week. They kind of fluctuate a little bit. Like, up until recently, they were looking really good, and then they kind of dipped off the radar a bit. But they're starting to climb back up there, making it to second place in ESL. Yeah, that's Double Tap's situation right now. If Double Tap had a solid, normal roster, then I'd be a little more inclined to, you know, really hype them up as a very big team. But they get good results when they have a solid third. But I would definitely say the NA side is a little cleaner of a picture. Like I said, Turbulence, Foremost. On the EU side, Weebs on Wheels is another good team there. The Season 2 patch is due sometime in the middle of this month. No idea when, exactly. Thoughts on Three Musketeers? Three Musketeers are a very solid team. They have been top 10 for a while, and then they kind of dipped out because they just kind of fell off the radar a little bit. But they might be coming back with that big ESL win. So, just further messing with my ability to do the EU power rankings is what Three Musketeers is doing. Yeah, that series is going to be really interesting and I think a lot of fun to watch. Well, if you want to enter the ESL tournaments, just go to play.eslgaming.com/Rocket League. You can sign up for any of those events for free, and you can play in those. If you want to play in Gfinity, just go to gfinity.net. You can click on the play button, then Rocket League, sign up for any of those again for free. Or if you want to play in the Pro League, you have to be really good and qualify. But right now, there's no way to qualify for the Pro League. But if we do a Season 2, you will have your opportunity. And just make sure you're constantly tuning in here or tuning into twitch.tv/Rocket League Central. We will always keep you informed as far as what's going on. The best thing I can say is it's February. Just February. Just wait it out. It'll happen when it happens. So I'll do one more call for questions. If you have any, now's a good time. We're approaching the end of the hour. You know how it goes around these parts. There would be a problem if you tried to use an unapproved teammate. But anybody who's on a team has been approved by somebody, like an admin or Cloud Fuel, before they get used. Yeah, no problem. I mean, if you're just starting out looking to play competitively, ESL is good for NA and EU. Gfinity is good for EU. Gives you some stuff to play in. We had tried doing player cards, but didn't really go far from there. We do talk about at least the country they're from, if we have that info. When they're kind of previewing each match beforehand. But, yeah, I'd like to probably do a little bit more of that in the pre-game conversations and stuff like that. Just to do that a little more thoroughly. I think that'd be good. But, you know, again, one of those things that we need to evaluate when we get a little further along or possibly for next season, so... Yeah, we got some of this info from the players directly, as far as like their statistical and biographical data. I thought that was the best series of the tournament between Flipside and Spectral. That series was insane, and I can't believe how close Spectral came to taking Flipside out. I mean, it went all the way down to Game 7 overtime. That was incredible. Is SK possible without Yemen at the moment? I don't really understand the question. I assume you mean, can they be a solid team without Yemen? Or, like, be an effective team without Yemen? And the answer is yeah, they could be, for sure. But they got work to do. The Pro League is not restricted to platform, though most of the players who play in it are PC players. But you can play on PS4 as long as you can get the room data and just enter the private room. Alright, well, it looks like things have quieted down. So. Let's do it one last time. Call for questions. You want questions. You have questions. I have answers. You can ask me about the competitive scene, the game itself, the Pro League, or really anything else you want to ask. Also, feel free to ask your question in the form of a text-to-speech message and a donation. That was pretty bad. Never mind. But point being, ask away, because I'm going to wrap up here probably relatively soon, but not quite yet. I mean, Yemen had a certain role that he filled on SK that they just need to adjust to the rest of the teams in the Pro League who are also playing exceptionally well. So, you know, all those things combined can be a little bit difficult. But we'll see how they do. They got a few more weeks to go. Scrubgilla has a team. I don't think it's a sponsored team, but he has a team. I don't know all the details on it yet, though. Could SK come back to being a top 3 RL squad? They could, certainly. They have the power to do it, the ability, but... they need to work a lot on that. What do I think of Knot's chances to make the playoffs? Very slim, in my opinion. Based off the way they've been playing, I don't see them qualifying for the playoffs against some of these other teams. I don't know anything about specific changes. I've been hearing that they might change the day that they do the event, but I'm not sure if that's the case or if they're actually going to do it or not. That's all I've heard, though. So, beyond that, I'm not sure. Because there's been a lot of talk about it, but the schedule on the site hasn't changed. It's still showing up as Friday. But, I don't know. Alright. Well, you know what? I think we're pretty good. So I think I'm going to wrap things up here. Of course that would start, right? Good timing on my part. Anyway, that is going to do it for today's Daily Rocket on Think here. Thank you all for tuning in, for your questions, for the conversation. Always wonderful, fun to watch, fun to talk about. Now Shogun shows up after I spent all that time talking highly about him. So he misses it all. He'll have to go back in the VOD to get it because I'm not doing it anymore. Anyway, that is it. Thank you all again for being a part of today's episode. I'll be back again very soon, as always. So take care. Have a great rest of your day. Don't forget to watch more Rocket League action every week. You know the Sunday routine. You know the Saturday routine. The Friday routine. All the other routines going on. It's good times. Anyway, but take care. Have a great rest of your night, and I will see you all next time.